Hello and welcome to this presentation. I'd like to show you an introduction to the tools that META has to offer for post-processing of results coming from CFD simulations. First of all, I'd like to point out that the user is able to launch META having the CFD option active at the launcher window. This will enable the CFD post toolbar here, which offers a set of CFD related tools as we will see later on. Now let's have an overview of the layout of META. As we can see, it uses a similar layout with the ANSA preprocessor, with similar icons in order to help the new user with an ANSA background get familiar with the interface easier. At the top of the screen, we have the various lists, the parts list, PID list, material list, and so on. Also the model list, where the user is able to select the active model, and the windows list, where the active window is selected as well. At the bottom of the screen, we have the focus commands. Then, they identify functions which are used to report result values, and then the drawing styles toolbar, from where the user is able to change the visualization of the model. Here we have the animation toolbar, used to capture and record animations. And here the labels drop-down menus, where the loaded results are listed. Finally, the info window here displays informative messages related to the currently active function. And of course, at the center of the screen, we have the main 3D window, where the loaded model will be displayed. Now let's load the model and see how we can handle it in META. The geometry of the model can be read directly through the CFD post toolbar. From this drop-down menu, we select the file format, and because we have launched META with the CFD option active, only the CFD solvers are listed. However, all the supported formats can be found under the default Read Results tab here. Back to the CFD post toolbar, I will select a Fluent file to load by clicking this icon button here. Okay, now we see that only the geometry of the model has been loaded without any results, and that information about the model has been printed in the info window. Let's see how we can manipulate the view of the model. In order to rotate it, we can press Ctrl and left mouse button. If we want to translate the model, we can press Ctrl and middle mouse button. And we can use Ctrl and both the left and middle mouse buttons to zoom in and out. Also, the mouse wheel can be used to adjust the zoom level of the model. Now, focusing actions may be performed using the focus group of buttons here. The OR function can be used to isolate a specific PID of the model, the END function to bring a PID to visible, and the NOT function to hide PIDs. For instance, let's click NOT and hide some of the walls of the domain in order to view the interior of the model. Also, using the drawing styles buttons, the user is able to activate the wireframe mode in order to see the surface mesh, activate and deactivate the feature lines, the shade of the faces, the lighting effect, and also have the model colored according to its PIDs, its materials, its entities, and so on. As we can see, only the geometry of the model is loaded. The results file is selected by default in this field, provided that it has the same name as the geometry file. In order to read the results, we first need to select the states to load from this drop-down menu here. Now, because this case is a steady-state simulation, only one state is available. In the case of a transient simulation, the user could have selected this button here and select the desired states to load. States are the time steps or intervals of iterations at which the results were written by the solver. By clicking the Read Results button, this window opens, listing all the available results that were written from the solver. On the left-hand side, we have all the scalar quantities, and on the right-hand side, the vector quantities. By default, pressure is activated in the scalar list and velocity in the vector list. Clicking OK, the selected results are going to be loaded, and the scalar results will populate this drop-down menu here. Likewise, the vector results are going to be listed in this drop-down menu here. And we also see that a new state has been appended to the states slide bar here. This slide bar consists of all the loaded states of the model. The initial state with no results loaded, and state 1 with pressure and velocity. Now, after loading the results, the fringe buttons here are activated automatically. This button controls the visibility of the scalar quantities, and this button the visibility of the vectors. By pressing the Labels button here, we can see all the results that are currently loaded in the database. If the user wants to delete a specific result in order to free up memory, they can right-click on it and select Delete from this context menu. Now let's see how we can read additional quantities from the results file, and this can be done by clicking again the Read Results button, keeping in mind to activate the Append Results flag. Now we'll click this button here, and this window pops up again. Now, this time, I need to deactivate pressure and velocity, which were by default activated, because otherwise they would have been reloaded again, and I would have duplicate entries on these drop-down menus here. In order to append the new result, I will select velocity magnitude from the scalar list and click OK. Additionally, keep in mind that if the append flag is not active while reading results, any previously loaded results are going to be deleted. Now I will deactivate the vectors in order to have a clearer view, and I can switch between the two scalar quantities that I have loaded by selecting them from this list here, pressure and velocity magnitude. As we can see, the fringe bar is automatically updated according to the minimum and maximum values of each result, and the model is colored accordingly. By right-clicking on the fringe bar, we have access to various options related to the visualization of the results. For example, we can hide it, and we can also bring it back. We can also adjust the minimum and maximum values of the fringe bar by selecting range limits and typing a new value, for instance a new maximum value here, and pressing enter. We can see that the maximum value of the fringe bar has been updated, and also the coloring of the model has been updated to correspond with a new value. In order to reapply the original minimum and maximum values of the fringe bar, we can select Recalculate from here. The activation of the Auto Range option allows for the ranges of the fringe bar to be updated each time we change to a different label from the list. As we can see, the values are updated. There is also the option to apply a non-linear spacing on the fringe bar by activating the corresponding option and going to spacing here. Now we can type custom values for each range by altering these values here and pressing enter. And we can also save the spacing by giving it a name. There is also the possibility to apply automatically a logarithmic spacing on the fringe bar by clicking on this button here. Now we see that the logarithmic spacing has been applied. In order to go back to the linear spacing, we just click on linear. The format of the ranges can be changed as well by going to format and selecting, let's say, scientific or fixed with a specified number of decimal points or auto. There is also the option to edit the text of each range by selecting the Edit Text List option, and here we can type a text value for each range. Let's say test. Now we see that the corresponding value has been updated. We can go back by pressing the Reset button here, or reset everything as well. From the Fringe Color option, the user is able to adjust the color of a specific range, or also adjust the number of ranges of the fringe bar by typing a new value here, let's say 20. There is also the possibility to select among a list of predefined palettes to be applied on the fringe bar, and the palette will affect the number of ranges as well as the colors. Now in our case, we will select the default palette. Finally, from the fringe options, we can select to view the results on nodes or on elements. We can also activate the wireframe to inspect the results on the mesh. And we can also view the results with a normal plot or a contour plot, as we can see here. switch back to normal plot. And also the same options are applied on the vectors fringe as well. However, additionally, we are able to adjust the vector scale and also the density of the vectors in order to display fewer vectors on the screen and make the database lighter. Now let's see some things about the PID list window, which is accessed by pressing this button. All the PIDs of the model are listed in this window along with information of the type of each PID. The user is able to select one or more PIDs to isolate on the screen by selecting them, right-clicking on them and selecting Show Only. There is also the option to explode the view of a specific PID by right-clicking on it, selecting Explode Selected and dragging the PID on the screen. In order to bring it back to its initial position, I can right-click again on the PID, going to Explode and clicking Reset All. I will bring some more PIDs to visible, like so. Now, through the PID list, there is also the ability to control the appearance only of specific PIDs without having to follow the settings of the Display Styles toolbar. And this can be done by selecting them in the list and then altering the drawing styles options which are found here. For example, we can select only one PID and then activate the wireframe only on this one, like so, in order to inspect the mesh. And there is also the option to enable the fringe mode for it. Now, as we can see, the rest of the model is displayed according to the PID's color and only the selected PID has fringe and wireframe enabled. In order to reapply the global drawing style options, we can just deactivate the per PID button. One more functionality of the PID list is that we can display additional columns in order to have more information on the model by clicking this button here. As we can see, there are many additional columns which report more info about the model, and in our case I will select the Elements column in order to see the number of elements that each PID contains. There is also the possibility to add integral columns by clicking this button here. All these additional columns perform various calculations on the model. For example, we can select a column showing the calculation of the area weighted average of the currently active label. As we can see, the extra column is added to the window, reports the area weighted average of velocity magnitude for each PID, and the sum for all of them at the last line. In order to obtain the area weighted average for another label, we will select it from the list and then click the Update button in the PID list window, and the calculation is updated accordingly. Now let's see how we can obtain the value of a specific label, for instance pressure or velocity magnitude, on specific regions of our model, for example elements, nodes and so on, and also how we can make measurements. All these actions can be performed using the Identify group of functions which can be found here. By clicking on the arrow button, we have a list of all the available Identify functions. In order to obtain the value of a selected scalar and vector labels on a certain element, we simply select the Identify element function and then we can click on the element. Now the corresponding scalar and vector values are reported and we can also enable the wireframe mode in order to see the mesh as well. If we want to clear any identified entities on the screen, we can press the iReset function which can be found here. We can also obtain the label values on a specific node, and to do so we will activate the iNode function. And then click on a certain node, for example somewhere here. And again we have the scalar and vector values reported. We can also activate the wireframe mode to better view the nodes, and we can continue selecting nodes to have the values reported there as well. However, we can make use of the Selection Assistant toolbar and the Feature Angle tool to facilitate the selection of multiple nodes. So, by clicking close to one end of an element edge, all the nodes along that direction are going to be selected. And by clicking the middle mouse button, we confirm the selection and we obtain the values for all these nodes. Now all these nodes are identified, and in order to clear the screen, we can press the iReset function again. We can also measure the distance between two nodes by using the Identify Distance function and clicking on two nodes. The distance between them is reported in the DD field here, and in our case it is 0.197 meters. We can still continue making successive measurements by selecting additional pairs of nodes, and the distance is reported as well in the DD field. Clicking iReset again, and let's switch to velocity magnitude and see probably one of the most important tools in this group, the IsoFunction, which is used to identify the minimum and maximum values of the selected labels, either on all the elements or on the elements that are currently visible. I will activate the function now for the visible elements, and we can see that this element here is the one with the highest velocity magnitude. The value is reported. And on the other hand, this element here is the one with a minimum velocity magnitude on the rear of the model. The IsoFunction can be very useful, as it can be used to identify regions of extreme values in the domain, and therefore it may be used to track down the cause of a divergent simulation, for example. Now, a powerful tool that can be used to identify entities of interest in the model is the advanced filter. This tool can be called from various functions, and in our case we'll see how we can use it through the focus commands. Let's assume that we want to isolate on the screen only the elements with a velocity magnitude lower than, say, 30 meters per second. We can do this by right-clicking on the OR function here and selecting Advanced Filter. This will bring this window up. In this window, we can specify one or more lines of filters, this means rules, to be applied on the model. The entities that satisfy all the defined filters here are going to be isolated on the screen. More lines of filters can be added or removed by pressing the corresponding buttons here. Now here we specify the type of entities that are going to be used for the filters. Also we can specify the type of elements, if we want to isolate only trias, quads, tetras and so on. And also we specify which states are going to be used by the filters. Each filter consists of 5 fields, as we can see here. The first field is only used when we have more than one filter, so I will click one to create an additional filter in order to show it. Add means to simply output the elements that satisfy the filter. Intersect means that the entities returned by the second filter will also meet the previous one, while remove means that entities returned by the second filter will be removed from the previous one. In our case we will use just one filter, so I will remove the second one. And from the second field we specify the type of entity to apply the filter on, in our case, elements. In the third field we specify the filter to be applied on the elements. In our case we need to calculate the velocity magnitude at the center of the elements, and so we want to select scalar centroid function here. And also we can see that in the info window we get some information about the expression that we can use along with the filter that we have selected here. Next, we need to type the expression for the function that we have selected previously, so I will type here less than 30. And finally, in the fifth field of the filter, we have the option to apply an additional filter to this line. For instance, we can keep the elements that hold the minimum and maximum values of the identified elements. However, in our case, we need to keep all the elements that have a velocity magnitude below 30. Now clicking OK, the filter is applied on the model. Now this is the result that we get from the filter, and we can see that only the desired elements with a velocity magnitude less than 30 have been left visible on the screen. Actually, this functionality, the advanced filter, can also be used in combination with other functions as well, for instance the NOT operation, and in that case we would have been defining filters to be applied on the model in order to hide elements instead of leaving them visible. I will bring now everything back to visible. And let's see now how we can mark any available entity in our model and add informative text in the 3D window. This can be achieved by using annotations. Annotations can contain text, images, results and so on, and are accessed through this button here. We have the option to create annotations on all the available entities in Meta by selecting New, on Elements, for instance Pick, and then select a specific element from the screen, and now we see that an annotation has been created pointing on that specific element. However, it would have been more useful to first identify specific regions of interest in our model and then create annotations that will be pointing on that regions. In order to do so, I will delete this annotation by clicking on the Annotations button and bring up the list of all the annotations. From the list I can select this one, right click and select delete. And then I will use the I function to isolate the minimum and maximum values on the visible elements. Now I can go to this arrow again, select new annotation on elements, and then select identified. This means that one annotation is going to be created for each identified entity on the screen. In our case we have two identified elements, and for that reason we have created two annotations. Now, annotations can be moved around by holding down the middle mouse button and dragging the annotation on the screen. We can also have access to the settings of the annotations by clicking on the list button here, and then we can select from the list which annotation we wish to modify, and from these tabs here we have the possibility to alter the pointer of the annotation, its shape, for instance. We see here that the pointer changes, also its size and so on. We can also adjust the text of the annotation. Here is the text entry field that corresponds to everything that is written here. So for instance I can press enter and add additional text, click apply, and see that the text of the annotation is updated. We can also adjust the alignment of the text by these buttons here, the direction of the annotation, and also we can adjust the color of the background by selecting a new one from the list, and so on. We have also the option to adjust the decimal points of the reported fields, of the reported values here, let's say 2 or 3 decimal points, and also we can adjust the position of the annotations. Right now we can see that the annotations are fixed on the 3D window. We can have them always attached on the identified elements by clicking on the follow button here. Let's have them both attached on the identified elements, and now we see that the annotations move around as we move the model as well. And we can also specify a certain distance at which the annotations are going to be away from the identified elements. Let's say 50. We can reset this distance by clicking Reset Offset. And by unclicking Follow, again we have the annotations fixed on the 3D window. And we can also dock the annotations to certain corners of the window, by selecting these buttons here, or we can select the annotations from the list, right-click on them, and select Explode of Model to have them arranged in that pattern around the model. In order to delete the annotations, we can just select them, right-click and delete. And I reset again. Now, probably one of the most important post-processing tools for CFD is the cutting plane. Cutting planes can be used to view the interior of the model by clipping the visibility and view results as contour plot or vector plot on the plane. One thing to point out is that META does not draw any solid elements, however the PID of the fluid domain needs to be visible when creating the cutting plane in order to see the results at the cross-section. So we need to make sure that the fluid PID is visible. Now, cutting planes are accessed through this button here. In order to create a new cutting plane, we can click on the arrow next to the button and then select New. Now we have the option to select one of the default planes of the model, or click Custom and pick three nodes from the 3D window to define a plane, a custom plane. In our case, I will select the default YZ plane. Next, we have the option to select if we want the cutting plane to clip the visibility of the model or not. I will select to clip it. And we see now that the cutting plane has been created. If I rotate the model around, I can see the interior of the domain. Now, in order to move the cutting plane, I can click on the button itself and the list of all the available cutting planes in the model opens. I can select the cutting plane from the list and switch to the Edit tab, and from here I can change the coordinates of the origin of the cutting plane or change the direction of its normal vector. The cutting plane is displayed as a circle and its origin is located at the geometric center of the entities that were visible when the cutting plane was created. So, if I want to move it, I can do this interactively by clicking on the Interactive Edit button here. Now I get some information about this function in the info window here. So, I can move the cutting plane by holding down the middle mouse button and dragging it along the direction of its normal vector. In that way, I can visualize the distribution of the velocity magnitude at the cross-section of the plane. I can also rotate the plane by holding down the left mouse button and moving the mouse around. And in order to realign the cutting plane with one of the axes, I can press Shift and F1 to align it with the x-axis, Shift and F2 with the y-axis, and Shift and F3 with the z-axis. In order to do so, I need to be in interactive edit mode. Up to now, we have seen how we can obtain the value of the selected labels using the identify group of functions here on specific elements or nodes of the model. However, cutting planes visualize the results on the cross-section of the domain, at the interior of the domain, and in order to report values from that cross-section, we can use the function IsectionPoint. So I will select this function here, and then we can pick points that lie on the cutting plane, on the cross-section of the cutting plane, and we can have the values of the scalar and the vector quantities reported here. Again, in the same manner as previously, we can throw away all the identified points by clicking the IresEnd function here. While still in the Edit tab of the cutting planes, we can click on the Flip button here and switch the direction of the normal vector of the plane. And also, there is the option to save the cross-section of all the visible cutting planes in Nastran, VRML or STL file, and have it ready to be imported in a pre-processing software like ANSA. There are also many other options here on this tab. For example, we can select to clip to cut the solids only at their skin, and in that way we can see the interior of the domain without having the results plotted at the cross section of the cutting plane. And also we can clip the visibility of the domain in both sides of the cutting plane in that way, and we can also adjust the width of the slice by altering this value here. And of course we can move the cutting plane as well and have this kind of visualization of the results. Now I will deactivate the slice width option and align the cutting plane with the y-axis to have the velocity distribution on the zx plane. Now as we can see, the results are plotted at the cross section of the cutting plane using the settings of the fringe of the global window. However, we can switch to the fringe tab of the cutting planes here, and we can uncheck this option here, follow window's fringe options, and this will enable us to change the visibility of the results on the cross section of the cutting plane. For example, we can select normal plot on element, and now we can see the results plotted on elements, or we can select nodes again and have the results plotted in contour plot, or in contour plot with lines separating the ranges of the contour, and so on. There are many options here. However, if we want to keep the global fringe options of the window, we can reactivate this option here. There is also the option to lock the fringe for the selected planes, so that adjustments made on the ranges of the fringe bar won't be affecting the visualization of the results on the planes. So if I go and adjust the range limits of the fringe bar, let's say maximum value to 40, now the fringe bar has been updated. However, the visualization of the results on the cutting planes are not affected. If I uncheck the fringe lock, we see that the results on the cutting planes are updated to correspond with the ranges here of the fringe bar. Moving on to the settings tab, we can change the clipping mode of the cutting plane. For instance, we can change to no clip, and we can see that the domain is not clipped by the cutting plane. However, we can deactivate the shade mode in order to visualize only the cutting plane. Also, there are many options here to adjust the line width or the line style of the cross section of the cutting plane, and so on. Now, as we have already seen, the solid elements are not drawn. However, we can visualize the section of the volume mesh with the cutting plane by activating the Show Mesh at Solids flag here. In that way, we can inspect the volume mesh that was used for this simulation, and we can also switch to the fringe tab and check the follow window fringe options and have the results plot on elements. This is useful to examine the quality of the mesh and the results as well. Activate follow window fringe options again and then switch to the settings tab, deactivate the show mesh at solids. Now, here we have many other options as well. For instance, we can have the cutting plane to be offset by a certain value, let's say 0.5. And we can see that the cutting plane is at a distance away from the model. We can also interactively move it, and this distance is going to be kept while moving the cutting plane. Now we will deactivate this offset distance here by specifying 0 and switch the clipping mode to clip by plane and activate the shade mode again and bring everything back to visible. Now, there are many other options in the settings tab here. For example, this draw only section flag can be activated in order to hide the circle of the cutting plane and draw only the section. Deactivate it again. And also we can activate the show hidden section here, and we can see all the hidden entities of the model that are hidden by the cutting plane. I will deactivate this flag again, and I will click interactive edit in order to align the cutting plane with the x-axis. Now let's move on to the final tab, the animate tab here, which can be used to create animations of the cutting plane along the direction of its normal vector. So we can activate this animate flag here, and by clicking interactive edit we can specify the starting and ending point of the path of the cutting plane. So by pressing the left mouse button and dragging the mouse, I can specify the end and the start of the path of the animation. So I can click the play button here, and I can see that the cutting plane is translated along the direction of the normal vector. From here I can adjust the speed of the animation, and also from this record button here I can save a video file of the animation and have it ready for my presentation later on. Now I will deactivate the animate option and actually delete the cutting plane because I don't need it anymore by right clicking and selecting delete, and also recalculate the ranges of the fringe bar. The next tool that we're going to see is the IsoFunction. IsoFunctions are surfaces on which the selected result, for example pressure, velocity, magnitude and so on, has a constant value. IsoFunctions are accessed through this button here. Now in our case, for example, we will create an IsoFunction of zero pressure. To do so, first I need to select pressure from the results list and then click on the arrow next to the IsoFunction button. Then select new, and in order to create a single IsoFunction with a specified value, we need to select the default option and then value. We have also the option to create as many IsoFunctions as the ranges of the fringe bar here by selecting the all option, and also there are many other options as well. Now in our case we will select value to create a single IsoFunction. This window pops up, and first we need to define a name for the IsoFunction. Let's say zero pressure, and then we need to define the scalar function or vector function according which the IsoFunction is going to be calculated, and of course define the value, in our case zero, and press OK. The IsoFunction has been created, and we can see it by disabling the shade mode here. Now pressure is zero everywhere on this surface that has been created. We can re-enable the shade mode and hide some walls in order to be able to see the rest of the model as well with the IsoFunction. Now by clicking the IsoFunctions button, we can access the list of all the available IsoFunctions and also all the available options that we can use to adjust the IsoFunction, the selected one. Now, as we can see, the color of the IsoFunction corresponds to the ranges of the fringe bar. This is done because the Show Fringe option is activated. If we deactivate this option, then the IsoFunction is colored according to its default color, which can be defined through here. Let's select another one, and we see that the color is changed. By reactivating the Show Fringe option, the IsoFunction again is colored according to the ranges of the fringe. We can edit the value of the IsoFunction by double clicking here and typing a new value, for instance 20, and we can see that the IsoFunction is updated, both its color and its shape, to create a new surface on which the pressure has a constant value of 20. We can also interactively edit the value of the IsoFunction by selecting Edit, Interactive, and then holding down the left mouse button and dragging the mouse up and down. We can update the value of the IsoFunction and we can see it interactively on the screen. I will click the middle mouse button to confirm the selection, and I will manually reapply the value of 20 to the ISO function. There is also the lock fringe option here, which if activated will result in the ISO function not being affected by any changes made to the ranges of the fringe bar. Now for example, if I right click on the fringe bar and apply a new maximum value, let's say 500, we can see that the model is affected, the coloring of the car has changed, while the coloring of the ISO function remains locked. And this is reported here from this message, locked ISO range from minimum to maximum. These values were locked at the time that I had pressed the lock fringe option. Now I will deactivate lock fringe and also recalculate the ranges of the fringe bar. As we can see, the value of the ISO function is reported on the screen as well, and we can deactivate it by deactivating the show value flag here. Activate it again, and there is also the option to create a smoother ISO surface by clicking on the corresponding flag. I will deactivate it again also. Now, what is a quite helpful feature is this follow ISO value option here, which if activated switching to a different result from the labels list, for example velocity magnitude, will result in the ISO function being recalculated and its shape and color updated to create a surface of constant velocity magnitude of 20, which is defined here, the value of the ISO function. We need to pay attention to have the auto range flag activated at the fringe and then switch to velocity magnitude. And we can see that the ISO function has been updated and now it represents a surface of constant velocity magnitude of 20. Let's switch back to pressure again. The ISO function is updated and let's deactivate the follow ISO value flag. Now switching again to velocity. The shape of the ISO function stays frozen while the velocity magnitude is displayed on its surface, as we can see here at the back of the model. Now we have a surface of constant pressure of 20, colored according to the range of the velocity magnitude on it. Let's go back to pressure again and reactivate follow ISO value. Now, in some cases, we want to recalculate the ISO function without having to switch to a different result from here, because switching results from this list would affect the visualization of results on other entities in META as well, like cutting planes and so on. In order to avoid this, we can activate the calculate ISO function at specific label from here, and this will bring up a list with all the available results. And now I will activate velocity magnitude, click apply, and now we can see that we have the model colored according to pressure and we have an ISO surface of a velocity magnitude of 20, colored according to pressure as well. We can go even further and deactivate follow ISO value, activate the lock fringe, and then switch back to velocity magnitude. And now we have the model colored according to velocity magnitude and an ISO surface of velocity magnitude of 20, colored according to pressure. Finally, we can apply transparency on the ISO function, and this can be done by deactivating the show fringe flag in order to apply the default color of the ISO function and then adjusting the value of the transparency from this field here, let's say 50, and we can see that the ISO function has become transparent and we can see the model. And of course we can export the surface of the ISO function by clicking the save button here, and we have the ability to select the Nastran file format, 3DXML, VRML and STL files. I can delete the ISO function by right clicking and selecting delete, and I will bring everything back to visible. And let's move on to the creation of streamlines in our model in order to visualize the flow. From this button here, by clicking the arrow, we have the option to create streamlines originating from a line, from a plane, from a cutting plane, or from a surface. In our case, we will create streamlines originating from a line, and if we make some node operations to view the inside of the domain, we can see that this line has been created, from where all these trimmed lines start. Now, by clicking the button itself, we have the list of all the available streamlines, and from here we can adjust all the options of the selected streamline. For instance, we can press Interactive Edit, and then with the left mouse button we can reposition the line tool inside the domain in order to view the streamlines at that point. We can also, with the left mouse button again, click and drag the start and end point of the line in order to make it shorter or longer. From here, from this Edit tab also, there is the possibility to adjust the direction of the streamlines. Now the streamlines are directed towards this side of the line. We can switch the direction by selecting forward, or we can have both directions. Also, from this field here, we can adjust the number of streamlines that will be originating from this line tool here. Let's say 20, and now we have more streamlines. And we can adjust the color of the streamlines by double-clicking on the color tab here and select another one, for instance black, and the streamlines are colored accordingly. However, we can visualize the streamlines according to the fringe style. If we go to the Styles button and activate Fringe Style, we can color the streamlines according to the scalar fringe or the vector fringe and so on. Now the streamlines are colored according to velocity magnitude. The same goes for the model as well. Let's assume that we want the streamlines to be colored at a different label from the rest of the model, and this can be done by activating the lock option here. And now streamlines are going to be locked to velocity magnitude, and if I switch to pressure, only the model is colored according to pressure, while streamlines still show velocity magnitude. There is also the shade option here, which, if activated, the streamlines are displayed as cylinders with adjustable radius. We can adjust the radius from here, from this field, let's say 0.02, and also with adjustable quality. And there is also the modulate option here, which we can activate, and then we can select a specific label from here, let's say pressure. And this means that the streamlines, their diameter is going to be changed according to the value of the pressure locally. Now, in our example, we have the model colored according to pressure, the streamlines colored according to velocity magnitude, and the diameter of the streamlines varies according to the local value of pressure. I will deactivate the modulate option and switch from cylinder to ribbon. Now we see that the streamlines are displayed as ribbons, and the width of the ribbons can be adjusted from this field here. And also, instead of modulate, we have the twist option. Now we can apply a twist on the ribbons according to the local value of pressure as well. Finally, in the Animate tab, we can activate the Animate option, and by clicking the play button we can visualize the movement of the streamlines, and we can also save the animation as a video file and have it for our presentation later on. The speed of the animation is controlled through this field here. Okay, deactivate the animation. I will delete this streamline here by selecting it and pressing Del. Now, practically the same things apply also for streamlines originating from a plane. We will create a new streamline set starting from a plane by clicking the new button and selecting streamlines from plane. And now we see that the plane has been created, and we can go to the Edit tab and, like previously, interactively edit the position of the plane, and with a middle mouse button change its position. With a left mouse button we can pick one of its edges and drag it in order to resize the plane. Let's move it a little bit further towards the wake of the vehicle. And also we can adjust the number of streamlines in the T-axis and also in the S-axis. And of course we have the option to choose the direction of the streamlines, forward, backward and both. now streamlines extend in both directions of the plane. We can go to the Styles tab and have the streamlines colored according to the scalar label. Let's switch to velocity magnitude. Now streamlines show the velocity magnitude. From the Edit tab again, we can activate the Restrict on Plane option, and by doing so, the streamlines are restricted on the plane from which they originate. In that way, we can capture the pattern of the flow on the plane. And on the wake of the vehicle, let's move the plane a little bit downstream. And we can have, in that way, the pattern of the flow downstream of the car. Let's delete this streamline here. And now let's see another option to create streamlines, starting from a surface of the model. We can click New, Streamline Set, from Surface. And now the PID list opens, and we have the option to select from the list, or select Pick, and click on a PID from the screen. Now we see that the streamlines that have been created originate from this PID, and we can color them accordingly by selecting another color to view them more clear, for instance black, and we can activate the oil flow option from here in order to visualize the attached flow on the surface of the model. By activating the streamline on multiple PIDs option here, the streamlines extend further away beyond the borders of the PID from which they originate, and we can also select the direction of the streamlines to both, and also apply more streamlines, let's say 100, and in that way visualize the attached flow on the car. Let's delete this streamline also and bring everything to visible again. Now let's have a quick view of all the available tools that CFD Post Toolbar has to offer. From the Reference Values tab, we can read the reference values that were used by the solver in order to calculate the force coefficients. We can click this button here, and we obtain the values that were used during the simulation. However, we can measure the frontal area of the model inside META, and in order to do so, we can isolate only the car, the PIDs of the car, press F2 to align the view, and then click the Measure Area button. Now the projected area is reported in this field here. We can also go back to the values that were used by the solver by clicking this button here. Next, the Report tab offers the ability to calculate forces and force coefficients, moments, surface and volume integrals. I will select force coefficients and select them to be calculated per PID and click Report. Now the PID list opens, and because only the car is visible on the screen, I can select the Select Visible option and click OK. Now the forces and their coefficients are being calculated by META, and the result of the calculation is going to be reported in the form of a spreadsheet. We see now that the forces have been calculated and the spreadsheet editor has been opened, and we have the side force, the lift force, the drag force, and the corresponding coefficients for each one of the visible PIDs here, and also the sum for all the PIDs at the last line. Next, through the Plots tab here, we can have 2D plots of the drag, lift and side force coefficients against distance or time. As this is a steady state simulation, I will select distance. Then I will click this button and confirm, and META starts the calculation and will report the plots on a new window. As we can see, the plots have been calculated by META and are reported in a new 2D window here. We have the drag coefficient, the side force coefficient and the lift coefficient here. In order to switch back to the 3D window, we just click on the corresponding window from the window switcher. Now, through the Surfaces tab, the user is able to create surfaces and have the results plotted on them, either by importing a file, for example an STL file, from here and pressing Create Surface, or by specifying an offset distance by which the newly created surface is going to be offset by a selected PID, and have the results plotted on it as well. Now in our case, I will switch to velocity magnitude and specify a specific distance here, let's say 0.2, and then click the Create Surface from PID button, and now the PID list opens, from where I am able to select, let's say, the roof PID, and click OK. Now, as we have seen, the new PID has been created and the results are plotted on it. However, I need to make sure before pressing the Create Surface button that the solid PID, the fluid PID, is visible from the PID window. All the created surfaces can be deleted by pressing this button here. Select the newly created ISO function and pressing Delete. And finally, we have the option to output any of the loaded labels here to that format by clicking the Output button here. We need to specify a file name and select Save, and we will have the selected label from here saved in a .dat file. Now, Meta also offers the functionality to calculate new user field functions by applying mathematical operations on the already loaded results. This can be done through the Calculate menu here and the Create User Field Function tool. Using this window, we can apply mathematical operations on the already loaded results, and we will use it now to calculate the total pressure from the already loaded static pressure and velocity magnitude. First, we need to select the type of the result, in our case scalar, and then, in this entry field here, we need to select to type the expression for the newly created field function. First, we need to select the state, in our case state 1. Then, we need to go to the elements result here and select the scalar function. While we are clicking on this list, the expression field automatically is filled with what we are selecting. And then we need to select the label, pressure. Now all this expression here corresponds to the static pressure which is already loaded. Then we need to add the dynamic pressure. So I will type plus 0.5 times the density of air times. Now I need to enter in the expression field the velocity magnitude. So again, I need to select the state, but now I will open a parenthesis and then click state 1. Then I need to specify what type of function I will be using, the scalar function, and then the label, so velocity magnitude. And we need this squared. Close the parenthesis. And now we have the full expression for the calculation of the total pressure. From here, we are able to define the ID of the state where the newly created field is going to be loaded. If we want it to be loaded at the same state with the other labels as well, I need to specify 1. Then I need to define a title for the newly created field, let's say pTotal. And by clicking Apply, the calculation takes place. And I will close this window. And now, at state 1, I can see that the newly created label is there, pTotal. I can select it now, and I have a newly created label holding the values of the total pressure. Now, through this window here, we can perform all kinds of operations on the already loaded results and also use mathematical expressions and so on. We can also make operations between various states or different models that are loaded in the Meta window. Now, it is a common case during the post-processing procedure to be able to apply an exact orientation on the model at various stages of the procedure. In Meta, this can be done through the tools Visual Views Management window. Here we are able to save the current orientation of the model by clicking Add and selecting a name for it. And now we can see that it is saved, and even if I change the orientation of the model, I can reapply it the already saved orientation. I can also select the view and click export and save it in a file on the hard drive, and then I can import it and use it in another session of META and on a different geometry. Now this brings us to the next topic, which is the creation of reports in the form of presentations in META. Through the Tools menu, META offers the Report Composer, which is a tool that can be used to quickly generate reports in order to present our results and save them as presentations in HTML, PPTX or PDF format. On the left side of the Composer we have the Report Tree view, which lists all the slides of the report, and on the right side we have the Current Page view. We can select the current page from the list, and we can use this button to add more slides to the report. Then we can select the current slide and start adding components using this button here. First of all, we can click this button here and insert a text to the slide in order to create a title for the slide. Now in our case, let's type IsoFunction total pressure equals 0. The title has been created. Of course, we have all the available options to change the font, the size, and the style of the font, and so on. And then we have the option to insert a picture from a file on the slide. However, we can also just simply click and drag on the Report Composer directly from the 3D window of META. Now we'll create the IsoFunction for the report by going to the IsoFunctions button, default, value, total pressure equals 0, and select OK. And now I can just drag the image from the 3D window in the slide, and the image has been placed there. Now let's switch to the second slide, and let's create here a spreadsheet that will report the area weighted average of the selected label here. In order to copy the area weighted average, I need to open the PID list window, select the desired PIDs, right click on them, and select copy to clipboard selected. Because I see here that the area weighted average has been already calculated using this additional columns button. Select copy to clipboard selected, close the window, then back to the Report Composer, and I can click this button here in order to open up the spreadsheet editor. I can press Ctrl and V to paste everything that I have copied from the PID window, and I can adjust the borders of the area that will be printed on the slide. Now we see that the spreadsheet editor has been inserted to the slide, and I can continue with the creation of a title and so on. Finally, we can insert a video in our presentation by clicking on this button here and then selecting an already saved video file, or we can click the arrow next to the button and select Start Recording. I need to specify a file name and select the format of the video file. And now everything that is taking place in the 3D window is captured by the video recording tool, the manipulation of the view, zoom in and zoom out, and so on. If I had streamlines, I could have animated them, and this would have been captured as well. And then back to the presentation, I can press this button here and select Stop Recording. Now, a thumbnail of the video has been created. I can resize it. And from these control buttons here, I can play back the video. This video will be saved in the presentation when I will export it in PPTX format. Of course, I can click the Save Presentation button and I can select one of the supported formats to have the presentation ready to be presented. Now, one of the most important things in post-processing is automation, and one way to achieve this in META is through the session editor. Every action that has taken place in the current META session, from loading of files until the latest function, including the preparation of presentations, has been recorded, and the whole session can be saved in a file and reapplied in exactly the same order and exactly the same way. In order to demonstrate this, I will open now a clean META session. I will load the same file. Then I will read some results. I will leave the default activated, and then I will perform some post-processing steps by activating some functions in order to see how this can be recorded in the session editor. Now the results are loaded. So we'll create an ISO function of zero pressure, visualize it, and also create a report just like we have seen previously. And place this image in the first slide. And now I will automate all these steps using the session editor by going to the tools menu here and activating session editor. Now all the commands that have been applied during this session of META can be loaded in the session editor by clicking this button here, Open Current Session. We see all the commands that have been recorded. And now I can save this session by going to File, Save As, and assigning a name. Let's say session1.ses file, and press save. One important thing to point out is that, as we've seen during this session, while I was executing some functions, some windows were opened waiting for some input from the user, for example the read results window. When I will open this session to execute it, these windows will open again, prompting the user to make a selection. Now, if I want to avoid this and hide all the dialog windows, I can uncomment this line here by deleting this symbol and save the file again. Now, in order to reapply all the post-processing steps, I will start with a clean database by selecting Clear, and I will select File, Open Session, and select the file that I saved previously. Now all the commands are being executed step by step, from the reading of the file up to the creation of the ISO surface and the presentation. The geometry has been loaded, and we see that the results are being read without any windows opening. The ISO surface has been created, and if we go to the report composer as well, the report has been also generated. In that way, we can also automate the preparation of presentations. A final thing to mention is that now we have reapplied the session using the same geometry to be loaded. However, there is also the option to set the file names referenced in the session files as dynamic parameters. By doing so, the time that will open the session to be executed, META will open a window asking which file to load. This procedure, however, cannot be implemented while working with a CFD post toolbar. In order to set dynamic parameters, we need to open the files using the default read results tab and then perform the rest of the commands. I will start a clear session now by selecting File, Clear, and Create New. And now I will switch to the default tab here, and I will read the same geometry in order to be able to set it as dynamic parameter in the session file, and also to apply the whole session to a different geometry. a modified geometry, actually a morphed version of the same model. And in the default tab, in order to read results, we need to switch to results tab here, and then we select one by one the quantities that we want to read, scalar or vector. In our case, I will select just pressure and press read. Now I will activate the fringe, and create an ISO function, just like previously. Deactivate shadow, and then go to Tools, Session Editor, close all the loaded files, and press Open Current Session. Now these are the commands that I have just executed in this session. In order to set the file names as dynamic parameters, I can click on File Names, and now this list here displays all the files that are reported that are referenced in the current session. We can see that the CAS and DAT fluent files are reported. I can select each one of them and then click Dynamic Parameter. I want to select the file name type for variables type, click OK, and then select the next one. This is the .dat file, and click dynamic parameter as well, and also choose file name as variables type. Now we can see here that the variables have been defined, and the next time that I will open this session file, Meta is going to ask which files to load. I will save this session file with a different file name. Session parameters dot ses and click save. Now I will start a clean session by selecting file clear again, and I will open the parameterized session file that I have just saved by selecting file open session, this one here, session parameters, press open, and now we see that Meta asks which files to load. Now I will select a morphed version of the model, the .dat file, and then the CAS file, and now exactly the same steps are going to be executed, but on a different model. We see that all the functions are being executed, and we get exactly the same result, but with a modified geometry. So, with the demonstration of this automated procedure, we have concluded this presentation. One final thing to mention is that you can find much more detailed information through the user's guide of Meta. Thank you very much for your attention.